Tonight's raffle is for a brand new car, $20,000. No. Chuck and Pat, they went to the Canary Hotel. There's a restaurant on top called the Coast Restaurant and Bar, and they got two $50 gift certificates for their work there. They went there and did an outreach for the whole place. We're going to give away one of these cupcakes tonight, and Mike will have Mike pick the winner. So get your coupons out that you're going to use. Nate, quit picking yours.
Okay. The 358.
Oh. All right, that was easy. So we're going to try to continue to do raffles, just to make them give away these things. Javier has given us passes to be in the museum. It's really nice. I wanted to ask folks, how many people here are museum members? Just as a curiosity to poll here. So about half the audience is members. Membership is about $60 for a single person that can bring another person into the museum, I believe. Mm-hmm. And so it's a pretty good deal and supports, you know, all the facilities that we use. So consider becoming a member. How many are SBAU members here? That's 9% of us are SBAU members. And how many first-time attended? Anybody? Is the first time they've been here? Very good.
That's how we receive them, with a prize.
Thanks. I want to remind you that, this will come up on the newsletter and the website, that May 3rd, our next meeting, will be Jane Houston Jones from the JPL Saturn Cassini mission. And she'll do an update on the Saturn Cassini, all the things going on with that project. And Tom Whitmore was a friend of hers. Was able to bring her, let me know about hers. So that should be a really good meeting. And before you do, Elijah, cell phones and the stun right now. And I guess Elijah will introduce you. And what we said on the website, Elijah gave us the save item. He's a graduate student, astrophysics at UCSB. Whose thesis research aims to detect the black holes in the center of nearby galaxies consuming stars. This involves developing software to search for nearly the entire Hubble Space Telescope archive, which I assume is just a bunch of bits that your data bits that you're going through this search that thing. Trillions of bytes of data. And we'll test theories about how these black holes form and evolve in their host galaxies, as well as provide a laboratory to test Einstein's general theory of relativity. Elijah is also studying piano at UCSB and has performed locally in Southern California as far afield as Germany. He has given many lecture recitals and salons in which he invites the audience to share more of the music than the typical concerts that he allows. Do you want questions during your presentation tonight, Elijah?
Yeah.
Questions are fine when he's doing presentation, I guess. And tonight's talk is Harmony of the Spheres. He's going to review the parallel histories of astronomy and music and our ongoing quest to find numbers in nature. And we have a new speaker system that and wiring that was done by Mike Ferris. Thank you very much, Mike. Pass over to you. Thanks. Thank you very much. It's unusual. We're putting the screen up because of the
light. He's not going to use it.
So we're going to do an old school today and have a blackboard talk. And I like this because it forces us to use our imagination. We're going to have some music involved. Not having something to see, I think, helps you listen better. It's a privilege to be here and talk to you guys about my two kind of passions, which are astronomy and music. And often people think they're very different things. But they've actually shared about 2,000 years of the same history, and they've influenced each other. Up until about the Reformation, music showed us how the universe worked. And we learned a lot about the universe from that. We learned a lot about ourselves. And around the time of Johannes Kepler, there was a split And astrology became astronomy, which I always thought was unfortunate. You know, geology is the study of the earth, biology the study of life. Astrology, I think it's just because astronomy is one of the oldest sciences, we got demoted to just naming the stars. But we can do a lot more than that. But astrology now has somewhat of a, you know, a bad connotation, especially in academics. And I hope to make astrologers out of all of you by the end of the talk, in one way or another. In a, okay, so how many people read their horoscopes? Okay, how many people believe them? No, that's the thing.
Okay.
How many people have been moved by a piece of music? Okay. All right. And how many people believe that the planets and the stars and the galaxies have an influence on your life?
How big is this one?
Okay, good. So, yeah, I hope you guys please ask questions as I go along. I'm going to do various things on the board here, and hopefully you can interrupt. I'm going to be talking a bit about ancient Greece and the beginning of it all, which is not the Big Bang, the beginning in terms of our understanding of how we understand the universe. And I'll take you up to Kepler, and then we'll have a little musical excursion, and we'll see how the harmony of the spheres propagates through all of music and a bit of history of music. And then we'll look for reconnecting points where music and astronomy are coming back together. Okay? So that's the plan. So we start in the mythological beginning of science, which has to do with the story of Pythagoras. Okay, so Pythagoras, this is 600 years before Christ. Pythagoras was born in Samos, which is an island off of Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey. And as the story goes, Pythagoras is a bit of a guru, as we'll see, but as the story goes, he was walking through the marketplace one day, and he heard a blacksmith hammering away, a few blacksmiths hammering away at an anvil on a piece of iron, and noticed that the sound was in harmony. There were three sounds that he heard. This is according to a follower of Pythagoras, who later recounted the story. We don't know if it's true, but it's so good it doesn't matter, right? Pythagoras heard three sounds. He heard clink, he heard clink, and he heard clink. Okay, I'm not very good singer, but we're gonna hear these sounds. And he thought to himself, this is a remarkable thing. Now, the Pythagoras and all of the Pythagoreans, and to some extent we're all Pythagoreans, we're looking for numbers in nature. Now, numbers have been in existence for quite some time. But to connect numbers in nature took quite a bit of ingenuity. So what are there numbers in nature? How many think there are numbers in nature? Okay. Or what about, is there a nature in numbers? Do numbers exist, is what I'm saying. Are they real? Okay. So you might ask, well, if there's one of something, or there are, I don't know, 50 of us in the room, how can you say there are 50 of us? Are we comparing apples and apples? We're all different. How can you say there's one of us made of these various pieces? There are philosophical problems with trying to describe, or trying to count things, right? We all know why we need numbers, right? It's to count. Because we're horrible at counting. Okay, so how many stars are on the board?
None.
How many representations of stars? I hear you guys ask famous questions, and I'm expecting some good ones. My mother's a first grade teacher. I go into her classroom, and I've been floored by the questions. Like one kid in the back, what makes the planets float? And I'm still trying to figure that out. So ask questions. Let's make this about. Okay. So there are three representations of stars on the board. You don't have to count to do that. Or you can count intuitively. You see that there are three. Now if I add a few stars, how many are there now? Okay, but not so quick, right? You couldn't really see six. You saw three, didn't even, they just registered as three. And now there are six, and this is about the limit, six or seven, of our perception of numbers. And there's a famous story that, also I don't care if it's true or not, but a math professor told me, if you have a field, and you have a blind in the middle of the field, a big tower with a little slit where you can shoot animals, and you've just planted some seeds in the field, but there are crows. Looks more like a, I don't know.
The Egyptian bird.
There are crows who want to eat the seeds, eat the seedlings out. And if a farmer goes out into the blind to shoot the crows know that the farmer's in there. They know, they understand the idea of one. They can't count, they just understand the idea. Two farmers go in, and one farmer goes out, they understand two. So they will not fly over the fence into the field because they know they'll get shot. And they have a memory because their brothers, you know, were shot. So if three farmers go in, which to them is like a lot or many, and two farmers come out, they still get it. But if four farmers go in, and three come out, it's like a lot went in, and a lot came out, I'll risk it, and then they can go, okay? I've never tried this, but if somebody does, I will pay for the study. Okay. So crows can do it to about three or four. We're only at about six or seven. All the rest of mathematics is there because we're horrible at counting. That's all it is, it's counting, right? And for up until Pythagoras, mathematics was just about keeping track of things. You're dividing up land, spoils of war, coins, wheat, all sorts of things. It was like accounting. But the Pythagoras and the Pythagoreans found something remarkable about numbers, that there may be numbers in nature. And the first hint at it was hearing these hammers hit the anvil. And Pythagoras, immediately upon hearing this, went home and decided to conduct some experiments of his own, I'll leave that there, where he got strings, or tallow, and hung them from his ceiling with various weights on them, so you pluck a string, it makes a sound. And he wanted to figure out what the tones were and how they related to numbers. So he did the following experiment. He got a string of some given length, and he hung weights from them, and he found that the weights corresponded to whole numbers, which we now know isn't quite right, but medieval scholars and everybody, you know, writing after Pythagoras didn't quite do the math. But what does happen is that you produce a wave, a standing wave, when you pluck the string, and that makes slight pressure differences, which then emanate from the string and go into our eardrums, and we can hear a pitch. And if it's a nice string, it's a really clean pitch, like you just heard on the guitar. And so Pythagoras came up with this idea that if you were to take the string and put your finger on half of the string, or divide the string length in half, you can get a new wave, or two waves, and that these two strings would be in harmony. So there's this sound, and that sound. That's what we now know of as an octave. It's the same note, but an octave higher. And it goes further, that if you put three notes in the string, you get another sound, and if I use the seventh fret of the guitar, we can hear a fifth. Okay? But what you notice is that if I take the string and I divide it by one, I get the fundamental. If I divide it by two, I get an octave. If I divide it by three, I get a fifth. And if I, it keeps going, if I divide it by four, I get a fourth.
Why do they call it a fifth?
That's good. He didn't call it a fifth right away. Yeah. This comes later. Ask that question again.
Remember, they can't count.
Okay, but this was the first discovery, at least in our Western civilization, that there are numbers in nature, and it had to do with sound. And this is a remarkable thing, right? That somehow the strings of these lengths and the lengths of the strings can, whole numbers can produce things. And not, it's not only producing something, it's producing harmony. It talks to us. It sounds good to us. It's the difference between, you know, this random, although that sounds kind of like Jimmy Hendrix, and a nice, clean chord on the guitar. In fact, all of music all around the world is based on this principle. Pythagoras then went on to study the visual world, looking for numbers. And most people will remember Pythagoras from his famous theorem, which is attributed to the Pythagoreans. We don't know if he actually proved it. But he noticed some symmetries in the visual world. For example, if you look north and turn by 90 degrees to look east, and then turn by 90 degrees to look south, and again by 90 degrees, they'll have you looking west. And if you rotated it again, you would get back to where you started. Now that doesn't have to be the case. But it is in our universe, at least in our three-dimensional Euclidean universe. Euclid came about 200 or 300 years after Pythagoras. And what he did with these tiles was rearrange them. He slid this one up. This is the best proof of the Pythagorean theorem I know. He slid that one up there. He moved this one over here. And then he slid this one over there. Hope this makes sense. And he was left with the four pieces with some square in the middle. And from here, he said, what I have is a square on the longest side of the of our triangle, and that the area includes all five of these pieces. And all he did was such a simple game, rearrange, and he put piece number two down here, and he put piece number three over here. And if you make a division like this, or you can use colored chalk, you see that you have a square on the longer of the short sides, and you have a square on the shorter of the short sides, and the area is the same. So the Pythagorean theorem that if this is our square, this would be A, and this would be, let's call it C, I think, conventionally. This is B, and this is A. That A squared plus B squared, that is the squares of these lengths, are equal. The areas are equal, which was the beginning of modern mathematics, and also modern physics, right? Because somehow people knew of formulas to get like 3, 4, 5 triangle, the Babylonians knew all about that, but they didn't know a formula that could be applied to all situations with right triangles. And all possible right triangles, they use sort of crutch right triangles, like we still do now, with the 45, 45, 90, and so on. And they had big tables of these things, which just seemed to work. But for the first time, he showed it works for all time. Okay. So finding numbers in the visual world and finding numbers in the auditory world happened more or less at the same time with the same. So Pythagoras had so many other ideas too, and many of them were passed along. This was sort of a secret. They were called the Brotherhood. And for example, Pythagoras had tables of opposites that he used as teaching methods. So there would be limited and unlimited. are two opposites. There would be right and left. There would be straight and curved. There would be male and female, light and dark. And he used these things to project his philosophy. And by the way, he's the first philosopher, self-proclaimed. Philosophers at the time were just called sort of sophists, who were wise guys. And to be a philosopher, a lover of knowledge, really begins with Pythagoras. And I think the difference is, you can go to a wise person, ask for advice, they'll tell you how it goes. But if you go to a philosopher, he wants to show you. He wants to awaken you to see the world and to reach his conclusions, not just to tell you what's right, like you should, don't buy that horse or something, it doesn't seem right to me. that their trust was in ratio, rationale, logic. And the Greek word for this was logos. Right? And in the Gospel of John, it says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word can be translated as logos from the Greek version of the Bible, which was ratio, rationale. And this is really where people looked for answers in ancient times. And we still do today, but we're going to get there. Okay? One follower, one Pythagorean a few hundred years later, was Plato. Now, Plato was a student, a follower of Socrates, who also has many Pythagorean views, but Socrates is obsessed with morality. He's not so interested in the mechanics of the universe, except where it teaches us that God made the universe as good, and it had to be good because it's God making it, and it had to be perfect. It had to have all the symmetries that we like in geometrical figures. So Plato has two accounts of a sort of cosmology. One is in the book of Ur, or in the myth of Ur in the Republic. How many people have read Plato? Maybe way back in school. Awesome. You probably read the Republic. Okay, at the very end of the Republic, if you remember, there's this beautiful story about Ur, who's a warrior, and he is killed on the battlefield, so we think. 10 days later, he is brought to a funeral pyre. They're about to light him up and shed tears and send him to the other world. Pythagoras was a firm believer in the transmigration of the soul and reincarnation and so on. And this is passed through into this myth. So what happens is, right before they're burning, he wakes up and says, "Let me tell you what it was like while I was dead." And so he tells this story of how he went to these fields where there are all of these dead, recently deceased individuals who, there were these two chasms, one from the earth and one going up to the sky, and one would send you down into Hades and one would send you up into heaven. And the way this worked is that if you had to approach the this whorl, and a whorl is a thing that you'd use to make yarn. Does anybody use one of those? Okay. There's a big ball on the end of it. And the story of how this all came to be was that this whorl is the whorl of necessity, which is a goddess. And the daughters of necessity are the three fates, past, present, and future. And they spin this whorl around. And this whorl is sort of hollowed out. And there are concentric circles which symbolize the planets. And that the celestial sphere, which is the geocentric view of the world, which is the one we have, even though it may not be the one that is, so to speak, the fates are spinning this whorl. And there are sirens on top of each one of these orbs singing. And that this sound is what makes the universe go around. Okay. Pythagoras, way back, claimed that he could hear it. And as a guru, you have to have some kind of special powers. You can't just say, like, you know, I just figured this out, I've got the credentials. You've got to, like, heal people or float or something. You don't just become a guru by being convincing. And one of the things that Pythagoras claimed was that he could hear the sound of the heavens and the celestial spheres, right? You probably got a little introduction with Professor Quetin about how that works, maybe, if any of you were here. I don't know when it was, actually, when she was here. Does anyone remember?
Last year. Stefania's.
And that these spheres rubbing together caused this harmony. And Plato set out to, in another one of his dialogues, the lesser known, but of all of his dialogues, the Timaeus is the one that had the biggest influence on science. And so Plato set out with all these things. There was a Pythagorean symbol, the tetractys, which looked like this. And the Pythagoreans would say, well, there's one. And Pythagoras was a believer that everything is one. And it's a remarkable idea, because when we say the word universe, that's what we mean. The word universe was invented out of poetic license from Lucretius' famous poem on the nature of things. And in a beautiful line in that, he says, we're not wont to feel each blast bit by bit, particle by particle, but all as a whole, or all rolled into one. So unus and vertere is one, and to turn into one. So everything turned into one, somehow. This is the entirety of it, right? So Pythagoras was the first sort of had this concept of the universe, that everything is one. And one is the loneliest number. So there has to be more. There have to be opposites, right? It just engenders two, so that the thing can define itself. And two you can bring together to make three, and there's all this symbolism that they go into, which I'm sure a lot of people really know a lot about, but this is where it gets interesting. Plato used this famous symbol, and by the way, this was what they would swear to. They would say, I swear to the Tetractys that I'm in the brotherhood of Pythagoras and I'll keep my knowledge secret, and which is what they did. Plato, through Timaeus, Timaeus is telling the story, has this symbol of lambda. And in Timaeus, he talks about how the universe was created. And some of it vibes with the republics and the doesn't. But what he does is he says there are these special numbers having to do with the ratios of the harmonies. Okay, so an octave is the ratio of 1 to 2. A fifth is the ratio of 2 to 3. A fourth, the ratio of 3 to 4. But already when you have an octave, if you take a fifth out of inside of an octave, you're left with a fourth. And if I take the fifth from the fundamental, open string, I divide it into thirds, or I'm using two-thirds of the string. What's left is here is the fourth between the octave and the fifth. Okay, so you can always hear octaves because it's the beginning of Somewhere Over the Rainbow. Right? You always tell an octave this day on. You can tell a fourth because it's Here Comes the Bride. I'll use this one. Tell a fifth, no matter where they are, which notes they use, because it's Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. Okay. And that da-da is the other note, and there's a sixth, which comes in later. So that these numbers have this hierarchy. There's the all-powerful one, and then they're two and three. Okay? And these together actually give you three and four. Four belongs here. And if you keep going and you look at the difference between a fourth and a fifth, you get a basically what we call a tone or a whole step, which was the ratio of 8 to 9. Okay. And if we put 9 over here, 8 over here, and then if you actually do some playing around with this tone and the fourth, and you take the ratio of these guys, you end up with the number 27. And for Plato, it all made sense now, because some of you are very handy with numbers, and you'll notice some patterns here.
Yeah.
Right? You see, there's one, there's two. We have squares on this side, and we have cubes on this side. And this just was like the perfect thing. It was like the key to the universe, okay, from the Hellenistic perspective. And it also described exactly how these sounds work and how music works. So we expect the universe to make some sounds. Now Aristotle comes in, and he's such a downer. He does his homework, and he's like, you can't hear this stuff. It would shatter things. It has to be really loud noises if they're these giant spheres. You know, the Pythagoras would say, I hear them because I'm the guru. Nobody else hears them because it's like if you're on a farm, you don't smell the stink. Or if you work in a really loud factory, you lose your hearing, and you don't have any more. And Aristotle says, oh, come on, and he doesn't. So in the Timaeus, Plato comes along and describes how the universe was put together. Using these ratios, the demiurge, or the god that built everything, made a concoction. And he added various portions of this and that. And it's actually very, very fun to follow, but it's a bit complicated. And this god made basically a band out of this fundamental string. And he divided it up in these various ways, and it's very complicated thing. And he cut this band in half, lengthwise, and then he laid it out one next to the other, so that they intersected in the middle, kind of like what they would call the Greek letter chi, we would call it X. And then this god took the ends and brought them together, and brought them all together at the same point, such that it made a globe. And there's one band, and here's another one. And what do you think these represented?
The ecliptic,
mm-hmm. Right? Off-axis, and the celestial equator. And this explained to them, you know, why there are these special bands, is that it came from all of these perfect ratios. Mm. And then there's all this detail about how the units of these, the zodiac actually appears on this band. Okay? And this was the classical sort of cosmology. Right? And it all made sense because the numbers just fit and it was perfect. And there were these harmonies. And I guess at this point we should do a little bit of listening. And you should hear the entire series of overtones. And there's a very interesting fact that notes that are low notes, they sound very rich and big. So the high notes sound kind of weak and feeble, the low notes big and rich. That's because within the big note, there are all the overtones of the high notes. So you can hear these if you... Tom, maybe you could do this better than I can. So I'm just touching the notes, and you can hear these inside the notes. So as we build up the overtone series, we're reinforcing the bass note. So you can hear this on an organ. It's very impressive. This is fundamental. Octave. Fifth. Okay, so already there, it sounds like perfect harmony. It sounds like a beginning of some piece of music. And even there, as we go to a third, actually affect you. And it's all affected us, so we're used to this. So they had like the Dorian mode, which would make you calm and relaxed and complacent and happy. Yeah.
we can hear noise. Uh-huh. Humans can distinguish between noise and pleasant music.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Why? Is that
pleasant music follows these rules. They're collections of these notes used together in the right proportions.
Right, but
noise.
My question was going: is that part of our genetic makeup, or did we learn this?
It's a good question. Various cultures have different tolerances for discord. Right, we're very used to, like, if we hear an octave, it just sounds good somewhere, you know. And we're used to our scale, but different cultures have had different scales. But they're all based on these harmonies. And it's amazing, isn't it, that we hear this, and that it sounds good to us, and that it looks good on paper. It's like the universe is speaking to us.
Resonance?
Now, resonance is the technical answer, right? Because...
But I mean, would be there some sort of mystical resonance between that and us?
Exactly. That's the whole point, is that there is, according to these guys. And maybe still. We'll see. But resonance is the key, right? So you have this one. If you notice that if you now put an octave with this one, the waves will match up, and they get what we call a positive interference. Okay, so every two of these will match up with one of those, and that matching up is what makes things sound nice. It's not grating, it's not scratching. If things are slightly off, and you can even add, you know, the four in there, this would actually be a chord of music. If you had pure tones, you put it through an oscilloscope, you would see something like this. If you had scratching, what happens is you get a beating phenomenon, where if you add the waves together, you end up with something like this. And this scratchy beating is sort of like it would sound. Do you hear that? That's the beating sound of discord. That doesn't sound like nice music, right? Okay. So there's a technical reason for why that works, and that somehow our ears are relaxed when we hear harmony. And they're stressed and troubled when they hear discord. So music is a balance between discord and harmony. Yeah.
Well, you said harmony, so harmonics does come into play in a sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The waves line up nicely here. Here, they don't line up nicely, and they sort of rub us the wrong way. Okay. Now, we've grown to tolerate discord over the years. Greek music had these modes. The Dorian mode was calming. The Phrygian mode was what they would use to send people into battle. Because it started to make your blood boil. And it would make you brave. And you would be a risk taker. And so the music was like an elixir for them. It was not something that you would just enjoy, sitting in a concert. It was like taking a potion. Yeah. It'll have a different timbre, right?
Yeah.
Than a sine wave,
right.
Or a sawtooth wave will have a different
right.
timbre. But if you, it's grating somewhat more than
right.
a sine wave. It's sort of it's a beep
right.
almost, or a grunt sound. And the exact nature of how these waves look is really what, like, if you basically play this note on a guitar or an organ pipe or a rock or anything that makes a noise, it's very difficult to get a perfect sine wave.
Right.
So all the instruments have their different characteristic shapes and bends, and that's what makes them sound different to us. Is that they're all slightly unique.
It's the third harmonics, I think, that are pleasant, isn't it? And the odd harmonics that are not. The odd harmonics are pleasant, and the even ones are not, I think,
So this has changed. So for the longest time, octaves, fifths, and fourths was all that we allowed.
Yeah.
And we basically We get there one second. There's one piece of music written on an epitaph in Turkey, in Greek, that is a complete piece of music. And we can hear it. And it's the epitaph of Cyclos, and it's from about 200 BC, maybe. And the words on this epitaph are, "While you live, shine, have no grief at all. Life exists only for a short while, and time demands its toll." What an extraordinary thing for the most ancient piece of music we've got record of. And you get to hear it, because it was written down, just so intelligible. Between the lute or a stringed instrument and the voice, there was no harmony involved. It was all in the selection of notes that we call the mode. It's like you have a piano in front of you and you just color code 7 notes and you only use those notes, and that was the mode.
It was using minors.
So major and minor hasn't yet come into the picture.
Oh, but they sounded like minors.
Yeah, it's weird.
It's a scroll, it's a minor.
Yeah, yeah.
And it makes you feel like that.
What kind of instruments do they use to drive pedal to battle?
I know the Greeks had plucked instruments, stringed instruments, and they sang. And I don't know, there were definitely some kind of horns, but I don't know of exactly how they sounded. But I imagine they must have used drum roll, right? Or a pulsating, something like this. But I'm not exactly sure what the orchestration was for that.
Also the voice, right?
Of course.
The voices were part of the whole.
Yeah. Voice is the biggest, and in fact, singing together is the best way. If you play on a sports team, but maybe, you know, they're in the military, it's like that. That really makes sense.
I don't know much about music, so if I make a mistake, let me know. So every note is associated with a number.
A ratio.
Okay,
numbers.
A ratio.
But
I'll just call it a number for
okay,
the moment.
Yeah.
What about the combination of notes that gives us music?
Exactly.
Is there a combination of numbers?
Yes.
Is there a rule, an equation?
Yes. There is an equation.
Oh, nice.
And it has to do with these ratios. Okay, so tones. This is a whole tone. If you on a guitar, we now have whole tones and half tones. That's what we're used to as a musical scale. I'm using whole tones and half tones. And there's a way to get a different ratio, which is like 237 over 256, which gives you a half tone ratio. And the collection of these all together give you a scale, and those are the notes you get to choose from and play together. Now, in the beginning, all that people could manage, right, and their Greek music was very monophonic. It was like one voice with perhaps a drone behind it. But it wasn't quite what we would call music. And we can hear this in the early Christian music, which used all of this. This was their recipe for music and for their view of the heavens. As these big spheres, these big orbs with the planets attached to them as they sort of waltz around the sky. Okay? And all people, when they talked about astronomy, it was almost like you can't blame them, right? They couldn't see exactly the positions so well. They just couldn't have a sense for measuring it. So they used their other senses to influence. It was empirical data. It's like they have to be in perfect harmony. How does that work? We listen. We listen to music. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit to Ptolemy.
I'm going to come full circle with string theory and vibrating.
You just took my punchline. Okay, so with Ptolemy, now Ptolemy was famous for his sort of epicycle theory of how the universe works, right? So he's got a geocentric theory, that's the Earth in the middle, and they had to be spheres, because spheres are perfect. And it all makes sense to us, this big, grand, unified theory of how the universe works. Every theory, by the way, in the early times was a grand, unified theory. If it wasn't, if it couldn't explain everything, or at least everything under the domain of this, people just tossed it. But we demand it from the beginning. But planets, as I'm sure you all know, go through this funny thing on the sky. They move relative to the fixed stars. Now, this is because they were on different speeds, on their different orbs. But if you want to make predictions of the planets, which are so important because the planets influence us, that music that's being made out there somehow speaks to us. Okay? And where the planets are and so on makes a big difference. And there are various things, I can go into that maybe a little if you want, but Ptolemy came along and wanted to explain, if this is, say, some constellation, we look at the planet Mars, which might move every month a segment, and it does this strange loop-de-loop motion known as retrograde motion, relative to the fixed star. So everything is moving around, right, in the celestial sphere. Mars will move relative to the stars, and as it does so, it goes backwards. And Plato might have said, well, this is why the planets are gods. They decide to go the other way. people have a war or something because of it, and it's Mars. But Ptolemy wanted to predict how this worked. So he came up with this epicycle theory, where you have what they call the deferent, which is the big sphere that everyone was used to. And then he introduced a circle on the circle. This is the epicycle. And the planet, in this case maybe Mars, was fixed on that epicycle, such that as this thing spun around and this one spun around, if you're on the Earth, what you would see is the planet go through kind of a loop-de-loop motion every so often, not all the time. And this worked fantastically. And Ptolemy got this model from music. Okay? He tried to, in order to get people to believe it, the scholars of, you know, first century Egypt, he had to figure out a set of chords that would explain this, how this works. And these ratios of these guys, you know, got tied into the whole musical system. And without music, nobody would have believed it. Because this was the biggest empirical proof of how things work. And then we go on, we have a few interesting characters. There was a guy named Boethius, who was an encyclopedist, I think the 4th century AD. He's the one who developed these three ideas of three types of music. There was music, musica mundana, the harmony of the worlds, the music of the worlds, which was this kind of stuff. There was musica humana, which was the elixir of music, like that our bodies feel the music from the heavens and our bodies actually make music within us. And then there was musica instrumentalis, which is the music that everyone's used to, playing on a guitar or a piano or singing. And that these all spoke together so that a person could actually play a note that was played by the cosmos. So there was a direct connection through music to with us to the universe. It's a type of religion, which is now the sort of religion of science, that we think the universe has the same rules everywhere, it speaks the same language of mathematics. And from the beginning, mathematics and music and astronomy were all tied together in a very significant way. So, as we jump forward now to Kepler, we're going to have to accept all this as the truth, because that's what everybody did for 1,000 years, longer than that. And we want to listen to the music made from this order. We're going to hear octaves, fifths, and fourths. We're going to hear a a mass for Christmas, which I actually got to sing with these Benedictine monks in the Alps. I stayed in a monastery for Christmas last year, and they're still singing this song on Christmas Day. What? Just try to pick out what you hear. Two different notes at the same time. Okay? This music is very similar to hearing the call to prayer. Right? Allah Akbar, right? It's that same illumination of words. And they illuminated their words in manuscripts with these flowers too. This is not really music, it's like spoken song What happens as an evolution is that we introduce harmonies. It's written by a woman in the 1150s. And this is from a play she wrote. She's a remarkable woman, East for example. From Dingin. We hear a drone in the background. Constant drone, which creates a harmony with the vocals. Okay, there are instruments which do this. A bagpipe is very good at it. If you've heard a bagpipe with a constant drone, the string version of a bagpipe is called a hurdy-gurdy, which is like a violin where you turn the wheel and it plays the strings on the side, and then you get to kind of play the notes on the violin with keys. Okay, so this is all according to the rules, and it was, these harmonies were defined by God. We use that to speak to God, to speak to really the universe, right, the cosmos. There was a musician at the Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris named Perrotin, and this guy was playing around with harmonies. He was the master of harmony. Everybody at the time, this is now like 12th century after Christ. He started a movable drone, and you're going to hear that in this piece. The drone. Which were just coming out of the monasteries into scientists and musicians' homes. And Galileo's father, Vincenzo, read all of these things in Timaeus, and he read all of the accounts by Aristotle. And he said, these accounts are wrong. If you hang weights from strings, it's not the ratio of 1 to 2 that works. You have to square those. He started really paying attention, right? You can see where Galileo got his savvy. It was from his father. And what he did, there was a famous battle between Galileo, Vincenzo Galileo, and Giuseppe Zarlino. And Zarlino introduced thirds into the harmony. And there are problems when you do this. When you when you try to tune an instrument from octaves and fifths and fourths, you can get certain notes right, but you won't get the others right. They don't match up. And this is what's known as the Pythagorean comma. Pythagoras himself knew about this. So if you take a note C, you can go seven octaves up, and an octave always ends up on C, right? So an octave up C, we have A, B, C, D, E, F, G. You keep going, you get seven octaves up, you get C to C, which is fine. They should be the same note, they should be in harmony. And there should be a ratio, which would be half, 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 and half, and so on. As the note gets higher and higher. As you can also get there with fifths, the so-called circle of fifths, if any of you are musicians. This is like your kind of keystone to harmony. You can use 12 fifths to get up there. So you go C to G to D to A to E to B to F sharp to C sharp. You keep going up all the way. You do it 12 times, C sharp to G sharp to D sharp to, anyway. You'll get to C after 12. And when you do that, you'd expect that there would be harmony there, but there's not. And they're off by some horrendous ratio of like 128.75 to 129, I think it's 127 to 128 or something like that. They're off. They have that discord. They sound like this. Now, this is a problem not only for fundamental tuning, which people were used to, because you can have stringed instruments playing together if they're built out of the same stuff, and you're all agreeing on the same key. So you can't modulate the harmonies. You start out in one harmony, and you can kind of go there, you can, you know. You can never go. Or you know, you can't explore musically. And also fretted instruments were coming into fashion. And these instruments needed to be tuned like a harmonica. You get like an F major harmonica. There are fixed spacings in the holes. Now you blow through these holes, you only get certain notes of the scale. And to build harmonies out of these certain notes was the goal. But you couldn't really modulate. So with Zarlino and Galileo's father, we introduced thirds into the system, which forced us into finding a new tuning system. If you start on C, you can have certain notes, but you can't modulate to a different key. You can't play with fretted instruments, which need to be sort of fixed in their holes. The system didn't work. So what happened was, partly due to Galileo's father, in fact, greatly due to Galileo's father, he introduced just intonation, or what we now call well temperament. And what it means is that we took these famous ratios and we said, we'll be okay with dividing up this Pythagorean comma, the difference in a few hertz, equally throughout all of the notes, such that a fifth won't be perfect. We tuned the octaves and then we divided up into 12 half tones. And so we let go of this perfect system. And if you think of what was happening simultaneously with Johannes Kepler and the Ptolemaic view of the universe, I can remind you here, Kepler read all of this stuff. He actually had a copy of Galileo's father's book, which was music, ancient music and modern music. And he read all of these Greek guys, and Kepler noticed one day, he was just speaking to a classroom, and he was teaching his students about the conjunctions of Saturn and Jupiter. I was very pleased to learn that both Saturn and Jupiter are in the sky right now. Saturn and Jupiter will overlap, which we call a great conjunction, and this is of extreme importance, right, if music and the harmony in the sky actually has an influence on people's lives. Kepler was an astrologer, that's how he made his money, but he was also revolutionary. Okay? And I mean that in the greatest sense of the word. He read the revolutionary book written by Copernicus called On the Revolutions, De Revolutionibus Orbium Celestum. published after Copernicus died in 1543 because it was too dangerous. And it was that the sun is in the center. Okay, and he read this forbidden stuff. Copernicus, Polish, Kepler, German, these are northern thinkers against the southern, sort of northern Protestant thinkers against the southern Catholic thinkers. And it made this big divide, which lasted in Europe even to today. And he read, that's where our root word revolution comes from, in terms of a political revolution. What does it have to do with spinning around? You know? It comes from this book, this forbidden book. So he thought about this geocentric model of the universe and wanted to make it work. And he noticed one day he was looking at the conjunctions, and he noticed that one conjunction after the other could be found by rotating. If you want to come up afterwards, I can show you the sketch from his book. And as he was doing this, he realized that if he kept drawing these equilateral triangles, oh no, I messed it up. Anyway, you keep filling it in, that you get basically a circle inside a circle. And an equilateral triangle is a special thing, right? And this goes back to Plato. There are two types of triangles which are special in the universe. These are like the building blocks of matter, like really matter. There's a 45-45-90 triangle, and then there is a 60-30-90 triangle. Anybody who's an engineer or anything, you use this all the time. It's like you memorize the ratios of the sides. You can, it's really literally a tool. And since God was the creator of the universe, he must have used the best tools. Because we use them. We understand that, you know, we can share these tools. Now with these triangles, you can get other objects. You can get, for example, a cube out of four of these 45-45-90 triangles. Out of these guys, you can make, this is going to test me, you can basically make an equilateral triangle with six of them. And these shapes are Plato's atoms. And if we extend these shapes into three dimensions, we can use cubes and equilateral triangles to build the perfect solids. Euclid made a proof that there are only five perfect solids. It was known before that, but he proved why. And you can use these shapes to make four of the five perfect solids. The easiest ones, which I can draw, would be a cube, right? You use six different faces of the squares, which can be built up this way. You can also have a tetrahedron, which is like a, that's all right. You know, four of these equilateral triangles. And that these were literally the elements, earth, fire, water, and wind, okay? And fire was this one. Why? Because it was sharp and it could be. And it had all these properties, right? And it all made sense. It's such a beautiful system. And then there are four others which can be constructed with these. There's a icosahedron, and there's an octahedron, which is basically this with a piece on the bottom, right? It's hard to draw. Representing water and air. And then there's the dodecahedron, which cannot be constructed with these two shapes. There are pentagonal sides in the dodecahedron, 12-sided pentagonal structure. And this one, they thought, was like the ether. It was like the universe. It was sort of like the Higgs boson. It made everything possible, made it all fit. Okay. So Kepler, as he's giving this, you have to think if he just stopped and like...
So you're not going to draw that last one?
You can fill it in later. You notice that there's a circle inside a circle which gives these conjunctions of the positions. And this might be like 1, 2, 3, you know, 4, and so on. And you can see a sketch. And then he thought, well, if an equilateral triangle gives you these, what if the spheres were nested? He tried it two dimensions, it didn't work. And then he thought, what about there are three dimensions? And I can use those five perfect solids to be the nesting of the planets, the six planets, right? And there used to be eight planets, because the sun and the moon were planets. Mm. But now in this new system, they weren't. what if you could mesh these together? And so he tried for 10 years to make it work. And he thought it would work perfectly because it was bringing everything together. The perfection of ancient Greek geometry with the musical harmony, he thought would give you the ratios of these distances. They were literally chords, which you could put in a particular key, and you could hear it, you could strum, like C major, and it would sound that good. But the planets actually had a music that was harmonious. It was bringing it all together as the new geocentric system, or heliocentric system, but it didn't work. And as the story goes, he went to visit Tycho Brahe, this guy working in Prague, Danish guy, he's a rabble-rouser. Hippo has to wait until Tycho dies in order to get his data. And he fit all of it, and it seemed to work perfectly, except for Mars, which was off by 2 arc minutes, less than 2 arc minutes. Think about 2 arc minutes. This is before telescopes. He used like a big sextant right on the wall, a big protractor. And that's a tiny bit. I mean, the full moon and the sun are about the same size, and they're half a degree. And this would be a 30th the size of the full moon. But it was off, and he trusted it. So Kepler knew that no matter how much he wanted his theory to work, he had to let go of it. And at the same time, music starts to take... This is what music sounds like with thirds. This is Monteverdi. This could be written today. Notice the modulation to different harmonies. Resolving that tension that's put into the music. Now the composer, I think, that completed this picture in the musical world, and this is why Johann Sebastian Bach is like a miracle for musicians. He took this well temperament, which divided up the scale, it was slightly off, it was like Kepler's ellipses, right? His only way out of this conundrum was to describe the planets by ellipses, which he thought was okay because an ellipse is like a circle from a different perspective. If you just look at this plate, it's a circle, and now you have an ellipse. So it works. And in fact, there are these conic sections, right? If you take a cone and you have a big samurai sword, you can slice it in all the possible orbits that you can get of two bodies. You can have a circle if you slice it here. You can have an ellipse if you slice it like this. You can have a parabola if you slice it like this, which if the two bodies don't orbit, you get parabola, it's a zero energy orbit. Or you can get a hyperbola if you slice it straight down, which is a positive energy orbit. And with the two things, this is like what hopefully asteroids do with the Earth. So these conic sections now describe a modern way that gravity works. Now Kepler didn't know about gravity. Galileo needed to dismember the institution holding up the geocentric view, as well as provide more evidence with his telescope that he probably stole from the Netherlands. Doesn't matter. You're allowed to if you're Galileo. But there is a musician, Bach, who put together all of these elements, and music exploded. It was like the scientific revolution, but the musical revolution. And in this first piece by Bach, you're going to hear taking simple elements, which are dun-da-da-dum and dun-dun-dun. Those two elements will compose an entire piece of music, and it will modulate to all the possible keys. And this is like jazz. I imagine Bach sitting up there, and all the instruments can play together with this equal temperament. It's off slightly, but it's good enough for us. And it frees music to wander into all of its reaches and where it's come from. So he takes these two elements, he permutes them, turns them upside down, he puts them in different keys, gets them in different instruments, and he's sitting up there and he's like, okay, violins, okay, trumpets, okay, oboes, and everybody's doing it. It's like this concerto was possible. And these are this is the second Brandenburg concerto. Something to be taken lightly. The idea of everyone today walking around, you know, with their headphones in, trying not to be hit by cars because they can't hear coming. I've done this. I've tried this. And you're walking down the street with this, and the world is like, it's like doing drugs, right? And everybody has that song that brings them to tears and makes them want to jump up and like start singing or whatever. It's powerful stuff, and it's powerful for all these reasons. So Bach gave way to Mozart. This working together of all of these pieces, this perfection of polyphony for the first time made possible. With Mozart, he took all of the tools of Bach and had a single voice. Okay, and this is about the time when all these political revolutions are happening all throughout Europe and the Americas, and the individual is becoming important. All the artists and poets, they're focusing on the individual. Mozart also wrote for cosmic proportions. He didn't write for, he wrote for pleasure, but his form was perfect. You can just hear it. This is a perfect triad. There's a Pythagorean accompaniment. Everything now is perfect Pythagorean. And then he switches. And that sweetness of the sound almost sounds empty. It comes from the fact that all these waves are lining up perfectly. A little bit of dissonance that brings you right back home. It's like you're being rocked in a cradle, right? This went on, and the proportions and the scale was just right in the classical period. With the buildings and everything, they looked right until. This is like a horror music for these perfect chords. Where's the form here? Where's the. Romantic music, right, which Beethoven inaugurated, was used for all sorts of things. This is a piece by Schumann, which is a very intimate piece. His wife Clara Schumann, also an amazing pianist. This is the sound of them making love. We're self-obsessed with music, and the Romantics started this. This came to its climax, or its crisis, with the famous opening, the prelude to Tristan and Isolde, right, from Wagner, who used all of these elixirs. He was a magician. All these musicians are really magicians. And if you would just trade music for, like, positions of the stars, which is where they come from, you'd find yourself an astrologer in a second. These chords never resolve. You don't know where the center is. It's going to resolve and then it goes somewhere else. And what he's doing with this is he's representing, without a center, without like a resting point, the sexual frustrations of Tristan and Isolde. Right? And more has been written about these simple chords, and not so simple chords, than anything else in all of music. And what they represent. Sound like going into battle. This is Gustav Mahler. And that's in fact what happened. We went to war, right? With the First World War, which just shattered Western civilization. Yeah.
Look at Pulse, the planets, and Mars, the rigor of war, right before 1914.
Yeah.
When that was World War One.
That's right. Yeah.
Marching into war.
That's right.
Battles.
There was another piece of music in 1913 by Igor Stravinsky called The Rite of Spring, which was equally sort of shattering. And the idea now is what to do with this music. We're self-obsessed with it. We've all drank and punched. And what do we do now? Stravinsky tried to layer harmonies together. He tried to say, well, let's have like a piece in this key and a piece in this key, we'll mix them together. And he gets these awesome sounds. It's 100 years old. But there was a rediscovery of musicians. Musicians wanted to reconnect to the eternal. And they developed new systems. And one of these, the 12-tone system, which Arnold Schoenberg put together with a few others, treated all the notes. He got rid of all of what we're used to hearing as harmony. And this is the same time as Max Planck and Einstein are developing the laws of quantum mechanics. And tearing apart how we thought the world worked. This is now music. It's probably 1930. No harmonies at all. Utter absence of harmonies. The whole point of it is Xenakis, who took sort of the lessons from, say, quantum mechanics and the further discovery of uncertainty and danger, and actually composed stochastic music. Like, he took like a random number generator or a Monte Carlo simulation or something and just delivered the notes, and then performers had to be like, well, how do I do this? But luckily, this, you know, they have electric pianos that can just do these things and play like 35 notes at the same time instead of 10. And this particular piece is called Beings. And like most modern art, it'll make more sense if you say a few words about it. But this piece is, it's basically what Monet must have looked like, and the early Impressionists, and Turner, and these guys. It's about the interface between light and water, and the motion involved. And that's what it sounds like. Sounds so far from those Gregorian chants. Like, what have we done? Okay. So luckily, this isn't the only type of music that's been composed. We don't have to take everything so seriously. But what are the lessons that we learned from this? I have a good friend of mine, actually, Stefan. This is his guitar. He's a postdoc here. Now he's moved on. He's at Harvard. And he is a high-energy physicist, string theorist. And Stefan is telling me that there are, inside of the things, these, there are these shapes. One is called a Calabi-Yau manifold, okay? And if you come up afterwards, I'll show you a picture of it on here. And it's this extraordinary shape, but it's not really that. It's a two-dimensional representation of a three-dimensional shape, which actually exists in six dimensions. And those six dimensions are what's needed to hear, or in other words, for these strings, which are causing these sounds, to propagate through space. And they only resonate in these higher dimensions, which are all curled up, and you can see this picture. And that these strings are like, they vibrate with these oscillations, which are these particular, which are a particular set of notes, and then every particle has its own note, and that together they somehow come together to make up everything we're used to seeing. And this is this what happens? Is this the inevitable consequence of letting physicists just go without having any experiment to back them up? Do we go straight back to harmony of the spheres? Do we go to these perfect Platonic solids? Are we reinventing this stuff? Are physicists different than they have been in the past? Now, there have been a few remarkable coincidences of patterns of numbers, like Plato's sort of lambda figure, that do turn out to actually work and teach us things. This one taught us how to play music. This may not be how the planets move, but it taught us how to experience ourselves in a new way with these elixirs. But for instance, the molecule, the electron transitions in a hydrogen atom, and the Balmer series, and these things were just random patterns of numbers which followed a particular formula that just seemed to work. And after a while, we kept asking the questions, how do these patterns of numbers fit together? And it taught us about the nature of the atom, the Bohr representation of the atom. There are other examples that don't work out, like the Titius-Bode law. Is anybody familiar with this? Okay, so if you make a map of the distances of the planets, let's say on this axis we're plotting distances, on this axis we're plotting planets. And all the planets are equally spaced according to this law. I think it looks like, 4 plus n, where n is taken from 0, 3, I want to say, No, we're doubling from 3 up. Let's see, it's 3, it's 6, it's 12, it's 24, 48.
96.
Yeah. 96, then we've got 192. Okay? In the 18th century, this was the rule for the spacing of the planets. And if in this system, the Earth is at a distance of 10, whatever units you like, you can reduce it to one astronomical unit, which I should have done for you guys. So in this system, Mercury would be at 4 units, right, or 0.4. Venus is about 7, or 0.7 AU. And this works for all the planets within a few percent. It's so amazing. The Earth would be at 10, as I said. If we keep going, we get 16 for Mars. And then 24.
Asteroid belt.
It's the asteroid belt. And in fact, Ceres, the largest asteroid, was discovered, which is proof of this. It's like we didn't have anything there. And then we found something. It's like, yes, it all makes sense. It's perfect spacings. And then we go to Jupiter.
Neptune.
Saturn,
I forget what, no, this was the asteroid belt. That's Jupiter, Saturn. And in fact, a brilliant young astronomer named William Herschel, who was very much like one of you guys, he built his own telescopes. He went out, he's a German-born guy living in England, hired his sister to be his hand at the telescopes. And he was out there with the best telescopes in the world that he just built on his own, just for the pure joy of it. He was also a composer. He spent all of his time teaching lessons, music lessons. And he went out at night and observed the sky with his sister for decades. And then he caught the attention of Neville Maskelyne, the astronomer royal, who said, who the hell is this guy? What is he doing? And he wrote to Maskelyne, he said, he thought that, you know, he saw things on the moon evidence of life there. And he wrote to the astronomer who said to him, well, you can't really say this stuff these days. Like, you know, people get the wrong idea. It's like, I'd much rather live on the moon than the Earth. You know? He was a freewheeler. Anyway, he discovered the planet Uranus within 2% of a value of what would be 196. And he really made British astronomy the talk of the town. All the French guys, Messier and all, they were doing all the best work at the time. And so there's this rule, and we don't know why it seems to work out like this, but Neptune, unfortunately, throws it off. Pluto brings it back, though. So I think, you know, this is a fuzzy law, and the astronomers don't like this. And if we get rid of Pluto, this might be the real reason. Pluto kind of recorrected the Titius Bode law. But anyway. I would like to, I guess, leave you with that. And I hope to leave you with so many questions about what it is that we're doing when we look at the night sky, what it is that scientists do when they're imposing numbers on nature or looking for the numbers inside of nature, and what do all these patterns do to us, right? And everybody's been affected by celestial objects. If you look at a sunrise, and you think of the way that the birds come to life, and the warmth comes out. It's no wonder. I mean, I think we got off on the wrong track with the horoscope thing. It was like it turned into a business. But these things do affect us in many surprising ways. So I'd like to take questions and leave you with some not so serious music. Bill Evans turned out the stars. So. Pythagoreans swear themselves to secrecy.
Oh, irrational numbers.
That was part of it. Is that they discovered things that they couldn't explain. Like, if you have a square and the lengths are 1, and you ask what the diagonal is, you get the square root of 2, and this is an irrational number. It can't be expressed one whole number over another whole number. And even in the language, it's irrational. It's like the devil's work, or it doesn't make sense. There are no numbers that can do this. And then you can actually prove that, that there are no numbers that, that do that. And they didn't know how to handle that. It was sort of like, if you knew, maybe as Freud thought he knew, that there were these bestial qualities in man that would cause him to tear at his fellow man and go to wars, that there were these subconscious things inside, would you make it public, or would you try to hold it back? And this was along those lines of dangerous, okay? But the other one was that they thought it was extremely powerful. And if these numbers in nature, like if you just go back to Pythagoras, and then you think about how that's propagated into the future, and what music is for everybody, and what science is for everybody, and the fruits of science is for everybody, it's extraordinarily powerful. I think he was just figuring out a way to invent a patent on numbers, so that he would be the richest man in all of history. They did actually, it was really only around Plato and a few other followers that started writing things down. And Pythagoras was expelled from, Proton, inside of the boot of Italy. And that is kind of the end of the, what we think we know about Pythagoras. And there may have been something that happened that made these guys sort of branded as dangerous dudes. Yeah. Other questions?
Computers can make pretty pictures now using equations and stuff like that, rock and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Can they write songs?
This is a good,
do you think that's common? Or?
So I have actually seen people, because like Mozart, for example, follows some very basic rules. And there are these computers that will make like a new Mozart sonata. He wrote 19 piano sonatas. And what if you could hear another one in Mozart's style? Mm-hmm. Mozart would write it himself. They're not that good. I don't know what it is. They're just not that good. Computer-generated music is
too many notes.
Yeah, that's right. I think it's a possibility that you can follow simple rules of a presence of a certain amount of harmony. Chord progressions, like the 1-4-5 chord progression, is something that Beatles to Bach to wherever it's. At the core of it,
there's still something to know that we know the computers don't, that they can't write music.
And this is another thing I really wanted to bring up was Herschel. He said when he looked out at the night sky, and if you go into it and see what he must have done, the scanning he must have done. He was the first guy to just scan like crazy. He said it was like hearing music, and this synesthesia I think is interesting because we're so obsessed with the visual. It's part of the reason why I actually don't really like PowerPoint slides. They just put you to sleep, you see, and you're like, you get the drug, like, oh, fancy picture. I could have put, like, you know, the School of Athens up there, and you get to see Plato, and your imagination doesn't really get engaged. And so he said it was like music, the spacings of the stars. And when he saw one that was slightly out of whack, it was like a wrong note. And he wrote about this in this way. And to think that as scientists, we're so obsessed with a simple straight line. We plot all the variables in the world to get a straight line. If it's not straight, we put on log axes. or if it's slightly, you know, we're obsessed with this. This is what everybody's doing. If you go to any talk at any sort of university, you'll see straight lines forever. And you think, like, what is our obsession with the straight line? What does that have to do with... It's predictable, exactly. We like to make predictions, but why just straight lines? Why not more? Yeah.
Well, I know one thing that they really are afraid of is when you, a straightforward example would be pendulum problem where you use the sine curve. Mm-hmm. Now, as long as it's real small,
right.
they feel safe.
Yeah.
But once you have to deal with boundary problems,
yeah.
Even most doctors I've dealt with, don't even want to go there.
Yeah, things get complicated very quickly.
Very, very quickly.
Yeah, and things go out of sort of linearity, as it's called, into the great unknown of chaos. And if there's anything that I've talked about today, it's the opposite of chaos. That's my goal. That somehow there's order.
So what are you going to do?
Let's get a drink afterwards.
I think we have time for one more question. It's getting up to 9:30, so.
So let's get back to one of your original questions, and that is the universe really mathematical, and we're discovering that by our observations, or is our math just a human way to try to express what we see in the universe? I think there's some of both, and I think it's a perfect question to sum up and finish, because I don't have an answer. And that is, you know, at the end of it all, will we be able to comprehend in excruciating detail the fundamentals of the universe?
Yeah. Yeah, let's thank Elijah for giving us a good talk.
Yeah.